Gameday U. Today marks the mid-season point for college football regular season, and teams are hitting their mid-season forms, and so are we at Gameday U. I'm your host, Joe Quinton, and as always, joined by Carson Williams, Reagan Ledbetter, and Kenneth Adair. Guys, everything is taking shape right now. What do you guys think about that so far?
I was talking to Reagan about this before the show started. I'm just surprised at how quick this first half of the season's gone. You know, just the other day, I was at Big 12 Media Days, and we were in Houston, and now we're halfway through the season, and OU's 4-2.
Man, what's it, week seven now? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's been a while. You started the year, you know, losing their first two of their first three games, and it was like, okay, where's this season going? And now we're in week seven. A team who can put up a lot of points now. We're seeing a whole new football team. Can they keep it going? Mm-hmm. But yeah, you're right. It's been a fast year. Everything's just kind of flying by, but you know, it's been fun.
Yeah, capping off on that, definitely flying by. The season's definitely rolling. OU, you know, got into Big 12 play, definitely stepped the game up. On offensive side, defense still has a lot of kinks to work out. But there are six teams right now that could possibly be potential playoff candidates. Yeah. And that's what's most impressive to me.
And the door's
so far
wide open.
There's about six that can win the Big 12, too. I mean, if we're looking at it, honestly.
Probably a lot more than that.
Yeah, this year it has obviously been way more competitive. We've seen that with a bunch of parity throughout the league, and that's been a consistent theme all year. And considering parity, Alabama and Tennessee are going to kick off this week. Tennessee's luck ran out last week against Texas A&M. They should have been beat earlier, but somehow forced a touchback to go into overtime and subsequently double overtime, but they couldn't quite get the job done. Carson, what are your takes on that? You think Tennessee has enough manpower, even with all the injured players, to come in and beat Alabama?
I don't think so. I don't think even if they were at full strength could beat Alabama. But like you said, Tennessee's coming off the loss. They're going to be fired up against Alabama today, but you just can't pick against Nick Saban, even on the road. You know, Nick Saban and Alabama. Alabama's won the last nine meetings against Tennessee. Tennessee last week had seven turnovers in that loss to Texas A&M. And against a defense as sharp as Alabama, you just can't have that. Even one turnover might get you. Josh Dobbs, I think, today will give Bama's defense some fits with his dual threat style, but I think ultimately Bama gets a job done.
I mean, minus the seven turnovers, I think for Tennessee, if there's a positive to take out of it, that was probably the best they've looked all season. Mm-hmm. I mean, they've had a lot of games where they've won and it's kept their ranking high, but they have not played well. They've had that luck. We talked about, like Joe talked about earlier, it's been luck all year, those final plays, those last quarter drives that's allowed Tennessee to win games. And now it's like, okay, where do they go from here? But they're playing at home. We know how raucous, you know, Neyland Stadium is down in Knoxville.
We were there last year.
But I think Bama just is rolling. You know, typical Roll Tide, running over opponents.
Roll Tide offense, Jalen Hurts definitely hasn't really been phased much. I mean, he's had some pretty big games against Arkansas, against Ole Miss, and he's playing outstanding. But one of the things I'm most impressed about with this Alabama team is that defensive front. I mean, lost a lot of guys last year, and the most they've given up on defense is 101 rushing yards this season. And that, to me, is probably the biggest impact for that team so far. But problem with this defense is that against Ole Miss, against Arkansas, they gave up to both quarterbacks 400 plus yards and three touchdowns. So Josh Dobbs is going to have to come in here today. He's definitely going to have to throw the ball. They're going to have to air it out, get the ball into this secondary. That's how they're going to win this game, and they can't have turnovers. You have turnovers against this Alabama defense,
or any team,
but especially with Alabama, you just can't come back from it. And so that's how
what happened to Arkansas last week when they just constantly threw interceptions to Bama. Bama just takes advantage of like no other. So it's a automatic loss.
And it already doesn't help. We saw Arkansas's defensive line exposed last week by Alabama. If we watched the game, you could see that they were just running all over them. And we're not even talking about what Bama's defense could do, or Tennessee's defense compared to Bama's offense, missing their leading tackler. So that's going to be another really big story this week. But moving on to the Big Ten, Wisconsin and Ohio State are kicking it off. Number 8 against number 2. Last time they met, Ohio State shut them out, averaged the first down every play. Reagan, where do you see this game going? Do you think this will be a good game?
Oh, without a doubt. But some may think this is going to be a high-scored, you know, shootout with, you know, high-powered offense and Ohio State. But I think this is going to be one of those games like we saw with Wisconsin and Michigan, low-scoring game where that, you know, it comes down to who gets that field goal late, who makes that play to win the game, who turns the ball over late, because Wisconsin's defense is stout. I mean, they are probably the best defense in the country right now at, you know, stopping the run. I mean, you can't run the ball on them. And I think, as we saw with last week, Ohio State couldn't run the football. So they had to air it out. And JT Barrett had a rough day. And I think that for Wisconsin, it's about getting pressure on JT Barrett and keeping him contained. But you're playing at Camp Randall. That's a tough place mm-hmm. to play. And I think that this is a must-win game for Wisconsin after that loss to Michigan. It's time for them to come back. And if they win this game, you know, they're right back in it. I mean, they're a top team, excellent program. But, I mean, they need to win this game.
You mentioned this Wisconsin defense. Their linebacking core is impressive with Watt and Beagle. Even with Chris Orr being out, they have definitely held down that rush defense. I mean, but the problem is they've only played teams that are one-sided, mm-hmm. that can run the football but can't pass the football. LSU, running team. Michigan State, running team. Ohio State is a complete offense, and that's going to be the test for Wisconsin's defense today, is can they stop the pass and the run mm-hmm. from a team like this with JT Barrett, with all that. I mean, and Ohio State's so athletic. For me personally, they're the most athletic team in the country by far, and Wisconsin's definitely going to have to take their game to a whole new level if they want to keep up with this Ohio mm-hmm. State team.
Seems like everybody right now is talking about Wisconsin's defense, and I'm going to keep that trend going. They're a good team. We've already established that they're a good defense, but they're allowing just over 200 yards passing, and they haven't really played a quarterback like JT Barrett yeah. this year, and he's averaging over almost 1,000 or not averaging. He has almost 1,000 yards receiving yards or passing yards. Wow, this is a very rough morning for me. 15 touchdowns to 3 interceptions. So I think JT Barrett. You mentioned last week he didn't have a very good day through the air. This week, though, he's not going to have two bad games in a row. I think today JT Barrett gets it done through the air big. And I think Wisconsin's really going to be exposed today. I think we got to see the Buckeyes here in Norman.
It's like an NFL team out there.
They are. They might be the best team
in
the country.
It's men versus boys.
And it's not just the team. I think Urban Meyer is the best coach in the country. And I'm going to go ahead and say that ahead of
he got me fired up on the sideline.
Yeah,
we didn't even interact with his team. It's just amazing.
Yeah.
So you're saying Ohio State wins this game?
Yeah. I think they win big.
I mean, stats tell the story here at least, because I pulled up some stuff for this, and Wisconsin only allows 100 rushing yards per game, mm-hmm. but Ohio State puts up 320 plus. So that's going to be a really, really big theme here. So we're going to have to see JT Barrett go through the air. There's just so much they can do. These teams just – it also will be kind of Ohio State's first true matchup against the defense with what you've seen them play. So,
Yeah, we know they didn't play a good defense here at OU. So,
yeah, no doubt about that. We've seen that throughout the season. But moving on to some more SEC play, Ole Miss and Arkansas. If we remember what happened last year, the Hunter Henry heave, basically forcing overtime with the most ridiculous play, 4th and 25, and they ended Ole Miss's chances to go to the conference championship to play Alabama, which is the team they beat earlier in the season. Kenneth.
Yeah, for me, Ole Miss is a very explosive team, especially on offense with Chad Kelly leading this offense. But he's going to have to, you know, keep his cool during this game. It's definitely going to get wild. But the question for me is, can Austin Allen step up today? He had a great game against Bama, 400 yards, 3 touchdowns. He's going to have to keep up with Chad Kelly. If he can do that, then they definitely have a big chance to win this ball game. But another key fact is Ole Miss has allowed over 100 rushing yards every game this season. Arkansas loves to run the football. They love to get down and dirty. They love to get in the trenches. You win that part of the game, you control the play clock, you control the clock of the game, they have the best chance to win this ball game.
I think for me it's about, can Arkansas rebound after that physical just beat down to Bama? I mean, anybody that plays Bama knows that they're going to be sore the next day. But that was a tough game at home for Arkansas to come in there and just have Bama's defense just throttle Austin Allen. I mean, they could not protect him to save their lives. But Arkansas can move the football. I mean, if you watched that game last week, they can drive down the field. But they get to the red zone, and it was those, you know, rush passes from Austin Allen, a young quarterback, throws interception. And Bama just, you know, will always capitalize on those mistakes. And so for me, it's about, can Arkansas rebound? But also on Ole Miss side, they love to use the perimeter. They love to spread the defense out, use the edges, and get it through the air. And Chad Kelly's an excellent quarterback at doing that. But, you know, Arkansas is going to be ready for that. So we'll see if, you know, Chad Kelly can, you know, execute.
We've heard that word so many times. I don't even want to hear it.
That's why I said it. I said it for you.
Oh, thanks. But you did mention Arkansas was able to really march down the field and kind of take it to the Alabama defense, which is impressive. They put up 30 on that elite Alabama defense, which is, you know, very impressive to me. But Ole Miss's defense this week and for the whole season really has not been very good. They're allowing 30 points a game and nearly 450 yards a game. So against an Arkansas team that did that against Alabama, I don't even want to know what they can do against Ole Miss today. So I think Arkansas, if they can limit turnovers, I like their chances today. Shout out to Mason Prince.
And if they can protect Austin, you know, they'll have a definitely have a good chance to win this game.
Yeah, I think so.
And fair enough. And we'll go now to ACC play. Two teams that are coming off a loss, North Carolina and Miami. Carson, what do you think of this game?
Last year, North Carolina routed Miami 59-21.
That's an understatement.
But I think this year the tides have turned a little bit. North Carolina's fallen out of the top 25. Miami's still right in there. I think that the Tar Heels are the only team in the country to not intercept a pass so far this season. And against a guy like Brad Kaya, that trend's going to continue today. I think he's one of the best quarterbacks in the country. A lot of guys have him as a top five, potentially, you know, top two pick maybe in the draft in a couple months. Along with Brad Kaya, though, Miami's defense is very stout. Number 10 in the country in total defense, only allowing about 285 yards a game. So I think Miami gets the job done.
This is a must-win game for both teams, especially Miami. If they win out right now, they have a spot, their first berth in the ACC playoff.
You could have two.
I mean, in the ACC championship game. You could have two, but North Carolina put up a whopping 78 yards rushing last week and a solid, 58 yards rushing?
Yeah, lost by three possessions, or 27 points, actually. So.
And after that amazing win over Florida State the week before, come in and just get throttled by Virginia Tech. But the thing for Miami is they still have to play Virginia Tech. Mm-hmm. And they're a team that's like on the rise, you know, 2-0 in ACC play. You know, so we'll see. But I think Miami's just, you know, playing at home. North Carolina realizes they're kind of out of it now. I think Miami's got this one.
Yeah, this is definitely a bounce back game for both teams. Both of these teams are very athletic. I think North Carolina has the edge on that. But the biggest thing for me is the only team who has a big win over a big opponent is North Carolina, which was against the team that beat Miami at home last week, which was Florida State. So I kind of think they have the edge in that way, but Miami is playing at home again, and they're going to want to get some redemption in front of that home crowd. So I think they're going to come out with a lot of hype, a lot of momentum. They're going to be pissed off. And so they're going to want to come out and play hard, and kind of feel like North Carolina is going to take it, though.
But it's like a free-for-all in the ACC right now. You got every team has a loss, other than Clemson, obviously. Mm-hmm. But every team is just kind of like
battling for second.
Exactly. So it's kind of just the race for second place. Mm-hmm. That rhymed, but that's pretty good.
Boy, look at
clever.
There you go.
Anyways.
All right, but yeah, that conference is up in the air. Playoff seeding, all of that is still to be questioned. But we'll move on to a little bit of Norman stuff right here. Bob Stoops, once again, is going toe-to-toe against his mentor in Bill Snyder. We have quotes and more in this next coming package.
On to Kansas State here this week. Coach Snyder and his team, Kansas State, always an excellent football team. Team that always plays hard, plays well, very sound fundamentally. Obviously, they've come here the last two times they've come here and beat us. We're very aware of that. So we need to keep improving. You know, the inconsistencies that we have all across the board, we've got to keep pushing to iron out and to keep making that improvement to be at our best here this week. No, I don't enjoy coaching against Coach Snyder's teams. They're too good all the time. I got great admiration and respect for Coach and loved my time there. I say it all the time. Those were great 7 years that I was there and learned a ton. So learned a great deal and still have great friendships from there. No, I don't recall that we have, I've had that many injuries all at once and so many young guys going in there and playing. The guys had a good attitude about it, kept, you know, those young guys, credit to them. They had their head in the game plan and practice, and they were ready to play and really, for the most part, played well. Didi's is, I don't know what the clock says, but he's as fast as he needs to be. He has great speed. He's really hard to overthrow for that reason, and he's finally back, you know, back where he's feeling 100%, and it's obvious, you know, he can turn short ones into big ones, and then he can get behind people as well, and really a sharp route runner too. We're still too inconsistent, you know. We're getting there. I think we're showing more and more signs of, you know, playing like we're capable. You know, but I think there's more there, so we've got to keep pushing for it, you know, to be better.
And we'll have more on that game later on in the show. But for now, we're going to go move on to our top national stories. Houston lost to the Naval Academy last week, and Navy, they had Tuesday off for school. That's how big this win was. This is the biggest win in the school's history.
You beat Houston. Hurrah.
Yeah. That's pretty big. The Congrats. Service academies this year have had their best start, and it's a huge story. Houston has pretty much sealed the deal that they're not going to be in the postseason right now, or for arguably. So what do you guys think of that? I mean, that's a huge win already for them.
Let me just say, let me stop you. I don't think Houston's completely out of it.
Oh,
yet.
Come on, Carson.
I don't think, because they still have a game against Louisville, and if they win convincingly, I think that they might still have a chance.
Yeah, but
they
still off.
But they like there still there still has to be a lot of other factors. But I wouldn't write them off yet.
But yeah, but they had to win out to even have a chance of being talked about to be in the playoff. And now that they've lost, it's like, do they really have a chance?
And it hurts with the way OU has played since then. So their win is kind of diminished in value from the beginning of the year. So that kind of hurts them as well.
Well, it's just like with teams like Houston and like Boise State used to be, when you don't have strong conference play, you have to win every game.
Yep, exactly.
And you have to win it convincingly. And when you don't win it convincingly, and when you don't, it definitely hurts you in the polls. I mean, number six, and then they just drop after losing to Navy. For me, Greg Ward, he had three turnovers against that team, and he just tried to put too much on him and tried to really take that team and not let the team take him. And, I mean, when you turn the ball over like that against a team who loves to hold the ball, loves to have possession, loves to grind it out, it, against any team, it's going to kill you offensively. He's got to come back and just understand, hey, I've just got to play my game. But again, what I was going back to with teams like Alabama, teams like Ohio State, they win when they are supposed to win. They beat every team that they are supposed to beat. And when you don't do that as a Houston football program who doesn't have a strong conference, it hurts you.
Houston, with all the talent they've got and just like the rep they've gotten over this, they should win out. I mean, just easily. Mm-hmm. There should be no problem. I mean, you have teams like Ohio State and Alabama and even an OU. They play tough games all year. So they're always having to have opponents. But when you have a Houston team who plays, you know, Tulsa and schools like that, they're not as tough matchups. So they should dominate their schedule and have a chance at, you know, being talked about for a playoff. But when you don't win out, it's hard for anybody right-minded to be like, you know, I think Houston should get a chance. But at the same time, I see your side because what did we see last year? Peach Bowl. They got their chance and played phenomenal against Florida State. Mm-hmm. So there's two sides to every story. I think with all the teams that could be in it this year, unlike as much last year, I think Houston had to win out. There's just so many good teams. I mean, you got two teams in the Big Ten that are lights out right now. Mm-hmm.
And moving on to teams that are for real and teams that can make the playoffs, what do you guys make of Washington? They are off to a hot start. They look amazing right now. Their quarterback, just phenomenal.
They're good, but it's still too early.
Your home state, though.
Yeah,
man.
I know. Well, you know, and I've grown up Washington State my whole life, and I'm going to say just wait till the season's over because there's that one game at the end of every year, the Apple Cup, and I've watched that game for years and years, and it's like an OU Texas. It's not talked about as much, obviously, because, you know, no one really cares as much, but it's a game that no matter where it's at, it's always a great matchup because Washington State's always just awful. I mean, that's inevitable. Washington's always been kind of, you know, mediocre. But somehow, Washington State can go 0-11 and end up winning that game. And they're going to be playing in Pullman, which is a very, very cold at that time of the year. Usually they have snow. So I think Washington's a good team. They're playing very well. One of the top teams in the nation. But we'll see how it turns out at the end of the year.
Look, Washington's quarterback, Jake Browning, has definitely stepped up. I think Washington is for real. Like I was talking about Houston with having to win games no matter what, they have won every game. They have dominated. The only game that was close was Arizona, where they won 35-28. But for the most part, they haven't scored under 35 points in a single game. And they haven't allowed over 30. So for me, this Washington team is definitely for real. They're serious about their program. They're stepping up. They're having a great season. I mean, they dominated Stanford.
Yeah, but Stanford's not impressive, and Oregon is atrocious.
But they put 70 points on a team. When you give that, it's very impressive. It's hard to say, oh, well, this team isn't for real. I mean, their offense is one of the most explosive offenses in the country, and their defense is right there behind them. They're one of the most complete teams in the country right now, and they're showing it right now.
Kevin, we're talking about Washington being good.
I'm going to go ahead and say I'm all in on Washington. I'm a little late, but I'm all in on them. Earlier this year, maybe it was like week two, I jumped on the Lamar Jackson bandwagon and have been captain of that bandwagon since then. Right now, I'm going to jump on the Washington bandwagon. I think Jake Browning, and I know you're going to talk about him, Kenny, here a little later on in the show. Not a good day for me. I'm sorry, guys.
Get your coffee.
Execute,
baby. I have to execute. Jake Browning, he's completing 72% of his passes.
That's
phenomenal.
104 to 144. Yeah. It's ridiculous.
For a guy and for a team that is so offensive driven like they are, and obviously with him having the ball as much as he does, that's impressive. And I think obviously the Huskies, they're very good. They have Jake Browning, going back to him, he's thrown for a nation-leading 23 touchdown passes. And it's not just the offense. Their defense is stout too, only allowing about 12 points a game. So they've got the total package. They can do it on the offensive side of the ball. They can do it on the defensive side of the ball. And I think that they have a chance to make it to the playoff if they can run the table.
Really, and would you even say, I mean, they have kind of a tough schedule left. They still play Utah, they play USC and UCLA, all teams that I think could easily pull out a win against them if they just play right. So, I mean, they are in control of their own destiny, but I guess we'll have to see. Do they kind of remind you of maybe last year's Utah? Do you remember?
That's true. I think that's a good point.
Yeah. Well, for me, Pac-12 always has one of those upsets. Mm-hmm. It's been the story for the past couple of years where you think a team is really dominant, and then they face some opponent where you don't expect them to lose, and they just.
Or the same thing is, you also have a Pac-12 team, and you get hyped about the Pac-12, that one team that's just offensively just dominating everybody, Oregon, as we've seen for the last however many years, and as soon as they play, they get their chance to play someone in another conference, it's like all the wheels fall off. Mm-hmm. It's just a. I mean, the Big 12 is kind of, you know.
Sounded like you were mentioning OU there as well.
I didn't want to say it, but that's what I intended to mean by that. But I think, you know, Washington's a good team. Like, we can talk about all we want. I can't believe I'm saying that. But, you know, they're playing well.
All right. Well, because there are plenty of surprises at this point in the season, there are also plenty of bad surprises. So this is about the time of the year when we start hearing about coaches being on the hot seat. Anyone in particular?
I think we all have the same answer.
We've already seen Les Miles get fired midseason, and it was inevitable. We've talked about it many times before.
Last year, too.
Off the air. You know, it was just they were going through a cycle of, oh, we need to fire him, and then they kind of rebound, and so they just go through the cycle. They finally canned him. I think right now it's a toss-up. The next coach to get fired, and it could be midseason, is either Charlie Strong at Texas or Brian Kelly at Notre Dame.
I thought you were going to say Bob Stoops.
Definitely not Bob Stoops. Not right now. But Charlie Strong's running out of chances. Last week's loss against OU, that would have been a huge win for him moving forward if they could have gotten it done in Dallas. But they still have to play Baylor, West Virginia, TCU, all really good teams in the Big 12 that have the capabilities of beating Texas. And I don't see Texas winning any of those.
The irony behind this right now, hold on. Who played week one, Notre Dame, Texas? We're like,
this is a great game.
They're both back to, you know, stardom. And now, week seven, we're saying, which coach is going to be fired next? Those two programs.
And then Notre Dame tonight taking on Stanford. I expect Christian McCaffrey to go off after last week. He was held to less than 100 yards. But they, again, still, they have, obviously, as an independent, they can schedule whoever they want.
Yeah.
So they have to play Miami, Navy, who we just talked about, Virginia Tech and USC. That's a tough schedule for the second half of the season.
I think Charlie Strong remains at Texas for one more year for a couple of reasons. Last year, they were both offensively and defensively disappointing. This year, the offense is really impressive. You know, they finally found a quarterback in Shane Buechele who's really stepping up. And so now they can actually score points. Now they've only got to focus on fixing that defense. If they can finally get some stops, and Charlie Strong made the move to take over defensive coordinator as well. And so once they can, you know, find stability on the defensive side, I think they'll be fine. Because right now, that's their only issue. And I think they're going to give Charlie Strong one more year. But for me, Brian Kelly, I mean, you're off to a 2-4 start.
Here's the problem with Brian Kelly, though. It's that his contract is far longer than a lot of other coaches. I mean, they just inked him to a new deal recently. So it's going to be hard to just, like, throw that away because we're still going to have to pay him.
I don't see Brian Kelly leaving Notre Dame. I think just, you know, coaching at Notre Dame is kind of a locked-in thing no matter kind of how you're playing. It's just, I don't know what it is about it. I think Texas, it's, I like what you said about, I mean, they're offensively finding a rhythm, defensively really struggling. But I think it all comes down to just the Texas fan base. They are sick and tired of losing. Mm-hmm. I mean, football is just not fun when Texas is not playing well, Notre Dame's not playing well, teams like that. And Texas has been just mediocre for so long now,
Ever since Mack Brown left.
Yeah, exactly. But even when he was there, it wasn't like the
you could see it start
the Vince
decline.
Young days. I mean, Colt McCoy was good. Guys like that, the Shipley brothers. But they haven't had any kind of excitement on that program for a while, and Shane Buechele was going to be like the next star of that team after the Notre Dame game, and look at him now. They're just an average team.
But I do know that several recruits coming to Texas have said if Charlie Strong goes, so do they. So Texas might want to hold on to their
head coach
right now.
Yeah, but what's more important, winning or
getting recruits?
Well, recruits get you the wins.
Well, I mean, obviously not if you're Texas. They've had a top recruiting class for the past X amount of years.
Charlie Strong didn't get his team until this year, and it's already been an improvement.
I think recruiting classes are the most overrated thing ever because who cares how many stars your players got? It's about how they play on Saturdays.
Yeah.
It's all that matters. Friday nights is over.
Ohio State Saturday and time. Bama have the highest recruiting, and they're playing well.
That's because they consistently have done it with their coaches.
But so does LSU for the last how many years? How many quarterbacks have they had?
Hey, hold up. Les Miles needed a quarterback. That was his one job. And
He's been a quarterback since he's been at LSU.
He needed one quarterback. Couldn't find it. Mm-hmm. And that's why he's gone.
Last good quarterback, Jamarcus Russell. How did that go?
He could throw
NFL quarterback of all time.
He could throw 60 yards.
We haven't mentioned Mark Helfrich, and we were dogging on Oregon a little bit ago. What about Mark Helfrich?
I think that's Mike Leach. I mean, Washington State. I mean, that's another one.
But you said they were never good. They could go winless.
Helfrich is definitely
missing. Yeah, but they want to be good eventually.
Helfrich is definitely missing Mariota right now. Mm-hmm. I mean, Oregon has been good for a number of years, but they're not one of those teams like Ohio State, like Bama, like Texas, like Oklahoma that are known for their football program. So when you have a decline, it hurts not only the football program itself, but the recruiting. And when you can't recruit because everybody else is getting what you want, you're not going to have good seasons. I think he's probably going to be the first to go in.
I think, actually, if we're being honest right now, the coach at Rutgers is gone now. And that guy is having a rough go. I don't know what it is, but
I don't know why they're in the Big Ten. I want to be honest.
Watching that Michigan game last week, 78-0. I'm just in disbelief. But
they've been torched by Washington played them this year, too, and just torched them.
But, okay, anyway, we've seen what has happened to some coaches because of their season starts. Guys, who are your surprises for Heisman? Who are your Heisman candidates? Any disappointments? I want to hear all about it.
I'm going to start off with Jake Browning.
Shocker.
Yeah, I know, right? me keeping on quarterbacks. But Jake Browning, you said he's thrown for 23 touchdowns. He also has 3 rushing touchdowns, so it's 26 in total. He's definitely dominating. But another guy that I really love, you know, I talked about I was in love with Shane Buechele. I'm kind of past that phase. I'm more in love with a guy named Jabril Peppers. He is a dominant player. He's a linebacker, but he's not just, and he's all over the field. He's got 35 tackles this season, but he's not just that. He's a punt returner. He's a kick returner. He's a wide receiver. He's a running back. He's got 2 TDs rushing. He's got a touchdown on punt return. He averages 17-plus yards returning on the punt. He averages over 19 returning on the kickoff return. He's all over the place. I think he needs to do a little bit more, have a little more success. But I'd love to see another defensive player
best,
from Michigan.
Best athlete in college football, by far.
He's Charles Woodson round 2. I mean, he's a star.
He's got a chance to be.
I was reading an article earlier this week about the numbers comparing those two. Jabril's are better. I mean, he's a guy who's...
And he's a linebacker. He's not a safety. He's not a cornerback. He's a linebacker. Yeah. And he's doing what no other linebacker for me personally has ever done.
Mm-hmm. It's impressive. I know you're going to say Lamar Jackson, so I'm going to leave that one probably to you.
Okay.
I mean, cool. Maybe if you're going to choose that one, but I'm going to go with, you know, Christian McCaffrey, you know, hasn't had the year the nation expected from him after that just dominating Rose Bowl game. I thought there was hands down. I mean, I was lobbying for pushing back the Heisman voting until after the playoffs and after the, you know, bowl games because
he should have won it.
He would have won it.
He should have won it.
Without a doubt. But this year he's had a rough go. I think the reason why is because, you know, it's last year Stanford came in and they had this star running back or star all-around player and was able to utilize them much more because defenses hadn't figured it out yet. And now they've realized that Stanford's kind of one-dimensional. And so everybody's kind of focused on stopping Christian McCaffrey, which is why Stanford is losing. But I think, I mean, it's a big game against Notre Dame today. It's a chance for him to kind of rebound after that rough, rough game against Washington. I think he's still on the hunt. I mean, it's easy for him to put up 300 yards in a game. He could be, you know, back in it in a half, if mm-hmm. we're being honest. The guy's electric. I like him, and I also like Deshaun Watson still. I mean, he's still a top star. He's at 1,500 yards on the season, 18 touchdowns. No matter how he's playing, he's always going to be, you know, in the race. But I think McCaffrey's
just the problem.
Big surprise.
The problem with McCaffrey is, like you said, what I've been saying all season, he's the only guy on that offense that can play. They don't have help for him. And when you only have to stop one person, like last year with Leonard Fournette, when you only have to stop one person, it's not that hard to do it, no matter how good you are.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm gonna go with Lamar Jackson. You see him right there scoring the touchdown. He's been on the. I've been on the bandwagon with him since nearly week one, week two, maybe. Even with the loss to Clemson, I think Lamar Jackson is still number one. 28 total touchdowns to just 4 interceptions. And again, I got to throw in right here. You see Trevor Knight. I got to throw in Trevor Knight on a roll with A&M. They just took down Tennessee. The Aggies might have 2 Heisman contenders with Trevor Knight and Myles Garrett. And Trevor Knight has revitalized that program. He has nearly saved Kevin Sumlin's job. And right before the season, I would have said Kevin Sumlin wouldn't have lasted 5 games.
Wouldn't that be something if Trevor Knight leaves OU, gets hated on by the OU fan base, and they want him gone, and the Knight in shining armor's over, and he goes to Texas A&M and wins the Heisman?
Hey, well, here's the thing. His best game was against an SEC team. It's not a surprise that he's doing so well in the SEC.
Defeated against the SEC.
Yeah, here's the reason I can't believe in Trevor Knight, and I'm going to go to another former Sooner, but he plays in the NFL. Sam Bradford is leading his team, but it's the team that's winning. It's not just Sam Bradford showing out. It's the same thing with Trevor Knight. For me, he's playing well, but it's the team that's playing great that's getting those wins. It's not just him that's dominating.
So then Peyton Manning's not the best quarterback of all time.
He
then,
is
right?
The best quarterback of all time. Don't bring
that's
that up.
That's
right another justice. Another you just disproved your another point. Thank you very much.
5
finally,
MVPs?
I've been waiting for this for 3 years now.
5 MVPs?
Yeah, all right, we'll stray away from the NFL guys, but do you guys have any players that have disappointed you in the Heisman race this year so far?
Leonard Fournette.
I think we can
all agree with that. But again, it's like McCaffrey. It's like last year. Doesn't have a quarterback. And so when you don't have another option, especially in the SEC, when most of them are good at stopping the run, and that's what they focus on, running back's just not going to have
a
good
day. I'm going to say Baker Mayfield.
Yeah, I was going to say stick right here.
Let's be honest.
Yeah.
Actually, Baker, Samaje, and Joe. We said this before the show today. I was talking to Carson. I was like, you know, I was talking to all you guys. I was like, if Joe or Samaje were on by themselves on another team, I think both of them, especially Joe, would be a Heisman candidate for sure. But playing together makes it hard for those two because they're having to share reps, and you know Joe's more in the passing game and stuff. But Baker Mayfield was like, everybody's crying because he didn't get invited to New York last year, and then turns out this year,
can't hang on to the ball.
You know,
hasn't been
making
able to produce
dumb
anything.
Plays, throwing interceptions, throwing the ball across the middle of the field late. Right. What you're taught at a young age not to do. And he's doing that in like the play last week. He almost lost in the game.
Yeah.
He fumbled that ball because he likes to be Baker and go run around and fling his arms up in the air. And look what happened.
Can you do that again? Yeah. Dalvin Cook's also another guy.
I was going to say him.
He's stepped up. I'm sorry. I keep taking everybody you're going to say. He's definitely stepped up, you know, in the later half of the season. But starting off,
I agree with you on that. But I feel like it's kind of like Christian McCaffrey. He's not completely out of contention. But we got to move on. Tom Brady is better than Peyton Manning. Concluding
note. Thank
you. Five MVPs. That's all
I'm going
to
say. Conclude our national coverage today. We're going to jump right into it. We'll break down the Sooners' offense and defense, and we'll be right back after that.
We got to hang on the ball. You know, we got to quit shooting ourselves in the foot. We just make still so many self-inflicted errors. And, you know, that on top of we just had a tough, you know, a couple of tough breaks in the first half. And but the credit and the good thing is our guys kept confidence regardless of that.
Yeah, every once in a while, each of us is going to make a mistake. But, I mean, you got to move on to the next play. You know, we watch it on film. We see what we did. Just try to perfect it next week.
I mean, they're a great team. They've always been a great team. But because we're University of Oklahoma, we're going to get everyone's best game. So you got to throw whatever film you see of any kind of plays that they don't think that or they don't look stellar. You know, you just have to throw that out the window.
Nobody in the country more sound than these guys. I mean, they do such a good job. I mean, it's just fun to sit back and watch them. And then they've just been outright dominant this year. They've shut down some. Really, really, you know, good offenses. You know, they're number one defense in the Big 12 for a reason.
Obviously, you know, K-State's not a big tempo team, but at the end of the day, we still take them just as heavy as every other offense because you see what they did last week, putting up a lot of points on Texas Tech. And it's just, you know, even though it's another week, we still prepare just like we did the week before.
I mean, to me, it's another challenge. It's the next game on our schedule, and all we can do is basically prepare just like we prepare for Texas and everybody else that we have played. You know, really, it's going to be on us. You know, I don't think that we're going to take Kansas State lightly at all because they're not a light team. They're not a bad team. They're a good football program. And especially, you know, from Bill Snyder, you know, coaching those guys up, we're definitely going to have to be ready and have our hats on.
And we've seen Kansas State and OU split their last four meetings, and they're going to meet again. Once again, Bob Stoops meeting his mentor, Bill Snyder. We talked about that earlier in the show. We also talked about some disappointing factors with Joe Mixon, Samaje Perine, and Baker's play. So, guys, for the offense this week, what do they have to do to take home a win in Norman?
I think, obviously, you have D.D. Westbrook, who had a phenomenal game last week. You've got to get him going again. He's finally 100% healthy. His quickness, his route running has really got him to where he is today the past 2 weeks. This offense right now is kind of where the coaches thought they would be or thought they could be. It's finally coming into fruition, and we're seeing what they're capable of. The run game last week, again, with Samaje Perine over 200 yards, very sharp, too. That's got to be, you know, mimicked again this week.
For me, it's about OU struggling to start fast. I mean, they've preached the last few years of we got to start fast, we got to score quick, you know, take over from the beginning. But as we've seen the last few weeks, yes, they put up a lot of points, yes, they've won, but it's more been a second and third quarter, you know, thing. And yes, it's worked out well for them against TCU and Texas, but at any time it could backfire on them and end up kind of screwing them over. But I think one of the biggest issues that's not talked about, and I don't want to question Bob Stoops' coaching abilities, but I think the only thing that hurts OU the most in their offense because of the hot up-tempo is just the random timeouts they call in the first quarter.
They're useless.
5 minutes into the game. What do you want to talk about, Bob? I mean, seriously.
Dead ball timeouts are the worst.
It kills them. They've done this for years. And I feel like no other team does it as much as OU. It's just constant, just call a timeout with momentum. And it just kills it. And the next play, interception, or three and out, or something like that. And that's what hurts a team like OU, who needs to start fast.
Well, going back to last week, you run out Austin Seibert for a field goal, call a timeout, come back out, he misses the field goal.
You iced your own kicker.
Why would you do that?
Well, last week we couldn't get through the first 5 minutes without having a play call issue or timeout being called from OU. I mean, last week.
Okay, those referees could not manage a college football
game. The game lasted 4 hours. The Super Bowl barely takes that long, so that was a problem.
With the halftime show.
Exactly, and all the commercials they do. Them Dorito commercials are great.
Anyways,
back to offense analysis. Yeah, like y'all said, they've got to get off to a quick start. You mentioned turnovers. They can't have those. And, I mean, that's for any team, but especially for this team when you're still trying to find your identity, get it back, get your rhythm back with Baker and with your running backs. You definitely can't turn the ball over. You can't make costly penalties either. That's been a big issue for this team. And they've just got to keep the momentum going. They got to start off fast. Late quarters are great when you can put up 28 and a half, but if all you can do is put up 28 and a half and the other team puts up 35, you're going to lose a football game any day of the week. That's math. I'm a
right.
journalist major, so
it's not great. Are you taking math classes, Mikey? I mean, Kenny?
Okay, so that just goes on to a point we were talking about earlier,
And especially for OU, what is it going to have to be for them? I mean, Kansas State, we've known, we see them this year. We don't really know a lot about these teams since we just began conference play. So we haven't seen much from the University of Oklahoma. So do you think that running is going to be an issue here? Because that's something that Oklahoma's tried to incorporate early on in the games. So
my key is running the football. I mean, I think that this is a game that Joe and Samaje need to have a big game. I think we're going to see that both of them have a big game because, you know, last week it was Samaje had an excellent game. It kind of didn't really seem like it because it kind of has happened so slowly. It was constant, like, you know, 10-yard runs, 15 yards, 5. But you got to utilize Joe more. We've been saying this all year. Utilize the guy because he's not just a runner. You can get him in the passing game. He's an excellent blocker, all these things. But I think at a home, first Big 12 game at home, it's a time for OU to run the football because everything is easier for OU and Baker Mayfield when they can establish a run game. Mm-hmm. They have to do it. I expect them to do it. Offensive line's playing better. Even with all the injuries, they're still playing at a high level. So I think, you know, it's going to be a big game for those two.
I definitely think the run game has to step up this week. Last week, Samaje looked fantastic, even though, like you said, it didn't seem like it. But Joe Mixon didn't really look like himself last week. Right. I don't know if there was an injury issue or if he had a mental issue before the game or something, but he just did not look like Joe Mixon. And again, he is an all-around running back. He is a true five-star recruit. And I think, you know, for me, I love Jabril Peppers, but Joe Mixon can probably be the best athlete in the country as well. They've got to get him incorporated into this offense. But I think you do that with having a balanced offense. I think you do that with Baker Mayfield throwing 25 to 30 passes a game and completing those passes and not having turnovers, because then that brings in the play action, and then they have to worry about the pass, and then you bring the run game back into it, and you just get it. When you get a defense to guessing and not knowing what's coming, you can do whatever you want with them, and I think that's how they win this football game.
There you go again, taking what I was going to say. Mix it up on offense. Lincoln Riley, I do think, does a good job of keeping defenses guessing. But I think you have to go to Mark Ehners more. Last week, you mentioned Joe Mixon had an off day. I think Mark Ehners did too. Yeah. They need to kind of reestablish him and kind of regain his confidence to get him back to where he was early this year and then last year when he was a touchdown machine. And then we've kind of talked about this. Baker Mayfield needs to protect the ball, limit turnovers. That has been an issue for him and the offense so far this year a little bit.
I feel like athletically, Baker Mayfield is just one of the best in the country at what he does, running around, scrambling. Sometimes mentally, I don't know if it's all there. He makes plays that, you know, you'd think a person with his ability would, in his age, would not do, but he does. It's just those dumb plays that we see that really hurts OU's momentum. And he's the leader of that football team. And so, you know, when he's throwing a pick late across the middle of the field, what does that do for your football team?
And D.D. Westbrook has loved playing in Texas. This the
yeah,
first
yeah,
week.
Yeah,
I mean, five touchdowns, almost 500 yards.
He loves that south of the Red River.
Let's see how he plays on this side of the Red River this
week.
Going
back to Baker, though, I think the reason behind all that is obviously we know what he can do within an offense, but I think it's once the offense breaks down and he has to become creative and use his imagination, I think that's when he thrives. But I think at times he tries to press too much and tries to be a little too cute.
I agree.
And that has come back to hurt him a lot.
I've said that about Baker. He's to want to go to the NFL, you've got to be more comfortable in the pocket. And I think, like you said, sometimes he's so good at what he does, just going on the fly, but sometimes he tries to do it when it's not necessary.
Yeah.
And he's got to be more comfortable in the pocket. That way, you know, if something simple's there, that's what you have to take. And I think that's what he's got to be better at, is staying in the pocket and taking what's there rather than trying to create something more.
Yep.
And it's certainly not going to be a 55-0 shutout this week.
But you don't know that?
It may be close.
But if – okay, you said it might be. It may be. So if that were to happen again, what would your defensive keys be?
I think they've got – Stoops has talked about it all week, and you heard him earlier – with all these injuries, these young defensive guys have really stepped up and played well.
Last
week, Jordan Parker, Parrish Cobb, Caleb Kelly, Capri Doucette. All these young guys have really come in and played well. Pressure up front, I think, to me, is a big thing. It's been a lot better the last 2 weeks down in Texas when, you know, they've got their two road wins to start the Big 12. I think it's a good start for them, but they've got to keep that going. No Matt Diamond, though. No Charles Walker. No problem, right? Oboe has been in there. He's gotten in the backfield.
Yeah.
He's putting pressure on the quarterback, getting in the backfield, getting sacks on quarterbacks, tackles for loss for running backs. So he's been a defensive force for Mike Stoops.
And real quick, I just want to touch on this. It also has been a very, very unfortunate last 2 weeks for OU in terms of players being injured and players even retiring. So that is a big point. It's one reason why the team hasn't been able to find quite clear of an identity as a football team. So how much do you think that's actually going to contribute to today?
I think a little bit. They've obviously kind of had to address that, and they've kind of had,
right,
had to prepare.
Out, so, yeah.
Right, and yeah, he's out 6 weeks. But, you know, good news on that, though. Tay Evans and Daniel Brooks both have opted to become student coaches in light of their career-ending injuries. So good for them. Really happy to see them still stay involved in the program.
You know, it's a big loss. I mean, it's hard to see all those players going down and stuff. But, you know, as Stoops preaches and all those coaches preach, it's next man up. And, you know, finally, I mean, us, we've been wondering, okay, well, where is that? We constantly keep saying next man up, and we've seen a lot of just kind of rough play from a lot of players who had to step up and from absence from Stryker and, you know, guys like that. But last week was finally, like, shining light on some players who had to come in at tough situations and played well. You know, Will Sutherland, guys like that. Played phenomenal and saved OU in that football game.
Chance Sylvie. Played really well.
Chance who?
Ahmad Thomas went down.
It was unbelievable to see those guys come in and play well. But, you know, back to what OU needs to do, it's just, I mean, I don't want to beat a dead horse on the whole.
Excuse?
No, that obviously, but the whole, you know, they need a cornerback who can play Oppo Jordan Thomas. But I think the biggest key is just getting pressure on the quarterback. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, no matter what happens in a football game, everybody's job in the secondary is easier when your upfront guys are getting pressure on the quarterback. Oboe has done a great job of that. Guys like that, Jordan Evans has done well with that. So I think if they can get pressure on the quarterback today, it's going to be a long day for Kansas State and a better day for the OU secondary.
You talk about next guy up, and Emmanuel Beal was mentioning in interviews earlier this week about how the second and third strings are practicing like their first strings. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what helps this OU defense through struggles like all the injuries that have taken place so far. I think it makes a team stronger when you face those injuries and you play well because of them. Like you were talking about the secondary, my key for the entire team is play a complete game. Last week, they played a great first half with the turnovers from Baker, and they only allowed, Texas 13 points in the first half?
Jordan Thomas had an incredible first half. Bob Stoops said probably the best first half he's ever seen.
And then you go into the second half, and he gives up, two or three touchdowns?
On the first three drives.
To go on that note about those 13 points in the first half, they turned it over in very inopportune places in the red zone, and they still somehow only managed to be up one. And so they
credit to
got
the defense
some, there, because that's insane to just go have a huge mistake, potentially just ruin your chances at the game, and then you still have the defensive fortitude to make the most of that.
OU would be so good if the offense and defense could just for once play at the same level at the same point in the game.
For the entire game.
We saw that a lot last year. That's what carried him to the playoff. They had the Big 12's best defense, and then the way Baker Mayfield, Sterling Shepard played last year, Joe Mixon, Samaje Perine, that was an incredible run.
That Bedlam game last year when they won the Big 12 title was like the perfect example of having a good defense and a good offense, because they just dominated Oklahoma State, who was a top team in the country. And at Oklahoma State, all that stuff going on, cold, and they just dominated. And this year, it's just one's good at one point, one's good at the other point, one's really bad, one's really bad. It's just constantly back and forth.
And going off of that, I think the hype that the defense wouldn't really face too many issues this season, especially the secondary, got to their heads, and it kind of messed them up a little bit and got them a little too cocky. But for me, it's not only playing an entire game, but it's not taking a play off. I've seen Jordan Thomas against Ohio State, against Texas, when he allowed all those, like those touchdowns, he was taking those plays off. It didn't even look like he tried. And if you're a leader on that football team, you can never do that. So I think this team has to play a complete great defensive game, and they can't take plays off.
All right. I completely agree with that, and we'll definitely see that because kickoff is so soon this morning. But today we are introducing a new segment in Gameday U. Today in Sooner History is what we're going to call it. And today in history, long time back, it was the day Bedlam was brought back. Gloria Noble is here with more.
I October 15th saw the Oklahoma Sooners in Stillwater for the renewal of the Bedlam Series with the Oklahoma State Cowboys. Both teams are nationally ranked, and Oklahoma had to get ready despite the publicity of the Marcus Dupree affair.
The Cowboys were unranked, while Oklahoma, even after losing to two top 10 teams, was 15. Oklahoma State led at the beginning of the fourth quarter 20-3. Running back Marcus Dupree was absent after a concussion against Texas, but mysteriously disappeared and did not play for Oklahoma. The Sooner Nation believes in Sooner magic, and that's just what happened. With two quick touchdowns, OU was bringing up the back. With 3 minutes of play left, Oklahoma still had a shot to turn it around. Head coach Barry Switzer initially wanted to go for an onside kick. Coach wanted a deep ball, but OU's kicker, Tim Lasher, didn't catch that part. Lasher booted a line drive that bounced off OSU Chris Rockin's helmet and into OU Scott Chase's hands, all while avoiding the ground. The kicker plowed a 46-yarder for a win, 21-20. Gloria Noble, Gameday U.
What a game, and it comes down to my favorite part of the show, national callouts, callout score predictions. Carson Williams, lead us off. Who is your national callout?
I'm going to have to go with Wisconsin. They're hosting game day. They got a big opportunity today to beat Ohio State. If they can do that, man, they are in the driver's seat in the Big Ten. They still have to, you know, battle with Michigan. But I think today would be a huge, maybe program-changing win for Wisconsin if they can knock off Urban Meyer and Ohio State. I mentioned earlier, Ohio State, I think, might be one of the, if not the best team in the country. Urban Meyer, I said, best coach in the country. If we can see Wisconsin today put up an impressive game, I'm going to be all in on them too, like I was Lamar Jackson, like I just was today for Washington. For the Badgers, get it done today. Why not?
Get it done.
Why not?
I'm calling out Tennessee. I mean, Wisconsin was another one of my top choices, but I'm calling out you, Tennessee. It's your chance. The whole nation wants to see Bama go down. Everybody wants to see that, unless you're in Tuscaloosa, obviously. But everybody wants to see Bama go down, and this is a chance Tennessee has. Everybody's saying your luck's ran out. You know, you have a tough game against A&M last week on the road. You're home. You get Bama at home. You've lost the last 9 games against this program. You have a chance to really shape things up and get your shot. I mean, if Tennessee beats Bama, I mean, and wins out, there's almost no chance you're not going to see them in that SEC championship game. I mean, wouldn't that be something to see a rematch of Tennessee and Bama again for the SEC championship game? But I'm calling you Tennessee. You know, there's a big game at home for you guys in front of a huge crowd. See what you can do.
Tennessee's just got to play a full game today. My call out is Stanford. You've lost the last 2 games. Not only have you lost them, you've been blown out by Washington and Washington State. Now that's just absolutely pathetic in my mind for Washington State to come in and just destroy you. Get some help from Christian McCaffrey. That's my best advice for you. I mean, you come in, you got probably the best running back in the country, probably the best playmaker, and you can't utilize him because you have no one else to give him. I mean, wide receivers aren't doing their job. Quarterback isn't doing their job. The coach needs to step up and actually call plays that will get this team confidence built back up and, you know, help them get some wins under their part. They're playing Notre Dame today. They've got to, you know, bounce back.
All right, real quick, my call out is going to be the Big 12 as a whole. Guys,
fair.
It's not really something I want to see whenever I'm watching CNN or the local news, and the biggest story is about Baylor, and it's not even a real football story. And it's just not what I want to see right now as just a college football fan. Like you guys were saying, it's weird whenever we're watching college football and Texas is mediocre. I mean, overall, the Big 12 right now is 35-23 overall, just record-wise, and their conference or out-of-conference play is atrocious. So, but we'll move on from that.
Thanks a lot, man.
Carson Williams? Hey, I'm sorry, but, you know, it is what it is.
Yeah.
Who's your OU call-out?
My OU call-out, we talked about him earlier, Dede Westbrook. Had a phenomenal 2-week stretch in Texas, but like Reagan said, what can he do on this side of the Red River? He's got to have a big day. Like I said, he's finally 100%. Baker Mayfield and Dede Westbrook look like they've really started this good connection that Baker and Sterling Shepard had last year. I think Dede Westbrook has got to have a big game. I think he will have a big game, and this could really jumpstart the rest of not only his season, but the season for Oklahoma. If they can get this pass game in some sort of rhythm, kind of like we saw last year, I think they have a chance to really get on a roll.
Mine is that up and down Sooner defense. I mean, it's just constantly a problem. You know, no matter how good the offense is doing, that defense is just constantly struggling. You know, we got to give a little slack to all the injuries. That's mm-hmm. tough to do. I mean, no matter what program you are, even Ohio State or Alabama, when you lose as many guys as OU has, it's tough. But you're playing at home. It's a big game for you guys. Show up. You have guys like Will Sunderland who, as you're getting their chances, I think Stephen Parker is the best athletic player on that defense.
He's so versatile.
Best tackler, you know, one of the best defenders. I mean, Jordan Thomas has been good, but it's like it's up and down, just like the defense. I think he gets a lot more credit because he's the best cornerback, but when you have guys that are freshmen coming out there starting, it makes Jordan look a lot better. But we've seen a lot of big plays thrown at Jordan Thomas, and he's given up some big, big touchdowns. They can't have that today. No ifs, ands, or buts about it.
And my call-out is the person who runs the defense, Mr. Mike Stoops. Yes, everybody's been calling for Bob Stoops. I'm calling for you, Mike. I'm going after you. You need to play. You need to call this game consistently. You have not been doing your job. I'm absolutely disappointed. Step up. Make the calls that need to happen. Get in your defense behinds and tell them straight up that they need to play a good game today.
All right. And real quick, my call-out's going to be Mark Andrews. We talked about this a lot, just about the inconsistency that our OU's offense has. Well, Mark Andrews, his first four games of the year, 211 yards and 2 touchdowns and 9 catches. Well, his last 2 weeks, OU has put on monstrous performances on offense, but he's only caught the ball 3 times for 35 yards, and he hasn't even completed half of his targets. So that's what I'm going to call out. But real quick, guys, final words.
My final word, I'm going to go with momentum. I already said it, but this has the potential to be a game that kind of gets OU on a roll. We saw it last year. That last year's loss to Texas, come back, beat K-State 55-0, and that propelled them to just run the table, make it to the college football playoff. I'm not saying they're going to do that this year, but I think it has a chance. You know, they're starting to kind of forget about those two non-conference losses, and so they have a chance to start today, make a statement. It's an early game. You've still got to show up, but get on that roll, still have a chance to win the Big 12.
Yeah, second half is getting underway of the season. It's coming out, but I think it's dominate. I use this word a lot with this team because a lot of times they come in and they, you know, have rough starts, but they don't dominate the teams they should dominate. It's just constantly just, you know, playing good enough to win. You have to have momentum going in, like you said, but in order to do that, you have to dominate against teams that you should beat. So,
for me, the word is win. I mean, you have 2 losses. Playoffs are not very likely, but you still have hopes for the Big 12 championship. Win. That's all you have to do.
All right, and my final word is consistency. You guys, the viewers, have heard this so much throughout the show. They need to play complete quarters, complete plays, complete halves, all of that. So, real quick, score predictions. Carson leaves off.
I think OU wins big. They get a lot of offensive production. I think they win 52-27.
I think OU starts early, and they win 55-21. Big game.
I think it's close for a quarter and a half, but after that, OU just takes off 59-24.
I'd love to see that, but I'm not fully convinced. I picked 38-28 OU just because I'd like to see a little more out of them. Let's see what they'll do this week. We'll see if they can win the series over the last 5 games. But anyway, thank you guys for watching Gameday U, brought to you by Gaylord College. We'll see you back here next week.